Hi everyone, welcome back. I am Pragya Mishra and I am the EVP of Customer Success and Operations at Courseplay. Courseplay is a 360 degree employee growth platform. The way employees upskill is ever evolving. And in this episode of our industry series dialogue, the topic of which is closing the skills gap, developing future ready talent. Join me as I dive deep into the world of HR with a seasoned professional who has navigated the complexities of regional HR leadership, change management, and talent development across Asia Pacific. Monica Diwan is the regional HR VP APAC of NIQ GFK. Welcome, Monica. It's great to have you in today's session.
Thank you so much, Pragya. Really a pleasure for me to join you today.
Looking forward to a super interesting conversation with you. Especially on a topic that a lot of employees are always exploring, and the learning and development team also always needs inputs on.
Yeah.
And I'd like to start with understanding the skills gap. So what are the most critical skill gaps that are currently faced by various industries? And then how does digital transformation play a role in widening or closing the skills gap?
Okay. See, when you talk about skill gap, Pragya, skill gaps would cater to or would be linked to a specific industry, and every industry will have a varied skill gap. You know, let's talk about, let's say, a manufacturing organization industry today. They have a different kind of a requirement and they have a skill gap there. Or maybe a construction industry that's also struggling with employees who want to really delve into that area. But prominently, if I have to look at broad categories wherein every organization, every industry is struggling today, is to do with big data. That's like the need of the hour today, that every organization, every industry needs employees or associates who can work upon data. Understand the data, read the data, analyze it, and make insightful stories out of that data. Okay. Or the second could be employees who are well versed with AI and ML, artificial intelligence and machine learning. That's number two. Not really in that ranking, but yes, that's one critical requirement nowadays. Okay. So these two. Plus, along with that, I would add one more, which is cybersecurity. Right? Yeah. So every now and then, we keep hearing challenges with respect to different scams or some cyberbullying or maybe organizations being hacked into. So you really need to ensure that everything is looked after, because nowadays, data is the new currency. So we have to ensure as an organization, we take care of and safeguard our data. So cybersecurity becomes crucial. So I would put these three broadly.
Yeah, so I like the point about cybersecurity coming last, because with so much of data that's already out there and so much of talks about what is AI, what is machine learning, what is ChatGPT, people just have loads of information, but they don't know how to execute the data or keep it secured. And it's uncanny, because I had a recent conversation with one of our clients on what steps, you know, a company takes in ensuring that the data is secured. So I'd like to slightly delve a bit farther away from the main topic, and like to take your input on what your view on securing data is. And I don't want to go into the technicalities, because, you know, that's the tech department's headache.
Yeah.
But as employee of a company, what's the best practice?
See, as an employee of the organization, Pragya, one is that we have to ensure that there is 100% awareness in the organization with each employee available with respect to do's and don'ts of data management and cyber management. Okay, so that's number one. Number two, this has to be a continuous exercise. This cannot be a one-time activity that, okay, I have given you the do's and don'ts, so that's how it continues to go. Okay. Then it would be very important to have a certification or a compliance associated with it. Right? how do you handle your systems? How do you handle your laptops? How can you share your passwords? Basic, very, very basic. Do not leave your systems open, right? Do not let anybody sit on your workstation and do anything there. So very basic things, because nowadays it has become all the more critical because my workforce is very aware. Okay. And since YouTube and Google and everything is giving them options of exploring of different ways of hacking and everything, so I am prone to falling challenge, you know, having a challenge there. So certification, compliance association, taking tough decisions and actions in case you find any action there, any such situation coming in, or of course regular awareness. So these are the things that we can continue to do with our employees. Of course, everything else is looked after by the tech department in terms of putting in the right checks and balances in terms of tech requirements there.
Understood. Yeah, because when ChatGPT and Gemini had just come up, you know, we were strictly instructed not to even put in our company name, and that makes so much of sense because they gather all of this and correct. That is how they are generating the data. So yeah, this was a much needed conversation for everyone to have. Now getting back to our main topic, and how do you feel that a company or an industry can bridge the gap of the main skills that you mentioned of big data, AI and machine learning?
See, there are various ways, Pragya. You know, the first starting point for any organization or any industry is to first understand the skill gap. And how that can be done is by evaluating your current as-is situation and where do you want to be. And then what is it that will take you to reach that objective? Again, a very simple, plain, vanilla solution in terms of the process. But yes, yep. What goes inside the process is what really gives you the perfect outcome. Okay, how well are you able to understand the situation? How well are you able to define your outcome and the needs or the competencies or the skills which will help you reach that outcome is what is needed. So which broadly means, one, you need to have a very detailed data available to base your decisions on, right? So you'll have to understand, you'll have to first have a definition of competencies and skill gaps as a database available for you. Okay. Then understand what is it which is lacking by evaluating the existing associates' skills and competencies. And that is how you'll be able to reach the final conclusion. Now that's one thing of identifying. After that, how do you bridge in? How do you fill that? Nowadays, we are all living in a very tech-enabled setup, right? We all love flexibility. We all love quick solutions, right? So that's the need of the hour. That's the requirement or an expectation of today's generation. So as an organization, we will have to respect this need. And instead of asking everybody to get stuck in a 2 or 3 days classroom sessions, give them those options wherein they are able to take their career in their own hands and pick up those bite-sized micro-learning options available. Okay,
yeah.
That could be one. Or mobile-based learning options. So nowadays, a lot of organizations are there who invest upon e-learning programs. So that's one good way of doing it. But the challenge that comes into an organization is that how do you promote e-learning? Right? So you'll have to ensure that your e-learning modules are regularly upgraded. They are relevant to the organization. They have very clear understanding in terms of which role, which level, what profile should look at, what kind of options.
Right.
Right. So these are few things. Then along with that, you can always ensure that the tech enablement is very much used in creating your programs and modules. right? So very simple things, but generally what happens is we fall prey to getting quick solutions and we do not look at mid-term or a long-term thing. We want quick short-term that, okay, in my T&I, I identified 3 competencies or skill sets to be worked upon. Let me call upon an expert speaker from outside, put everybody together in a 2-day session, and yes, I will get a transformed course from tomorrow.
That's
not happen.
Correct.
All of us know, and we've realized it much more after COVID, wherein when we were forced to work online, our span of focus online or in anything is not more than 40 to 45 minutes.
Correct.
Okay. So in case you can break up those programs in smaller sessions, people would be able to, you know, focus more. You'll get more efficiency out of it. You'll get more engaged associate. You'll get a learner who will be happy to pick up those things and imbibe them in their future working. So these are a few things that I can come up with.
Makes sense. I really like the point of mobile-based learning, because we are also calling it anytime learning.
Correct.
Keep the data ready with the employee and they can have it anywhere. But then don't you think that's a bit distracting also? This is something I've always wondered. I want to know your point of view in this.
See, it is. Okay, so I would say that it's the way you want to take it. Mobile in itself as an instrument or a device is distracting.
Yeah.
Right? As soon as you have some time, you pick up a mobile, you go to Insta, you fall prey to watching reels.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's something which everybody is doing. Can you convert that into, you know, that usage of that time into something constructive is what we need to think of. Okay. There can be gamification of your training programs.
Yeah.
Right? There can be many things. So you can always have these virtual options, augmented realities. So many such things. And kids or the youngsters nowadays, they would love to pick up these learning modules. Right? They're anyways playing video games on the mobile. There are so many games that they continue to play. So instead of that, if you position a training game and say that, okay, it's a 15-minute quick game, let's play it. I know of an organization who runs this program, a similar augmented reality program for its field workers, wherein they help them train on the way that you should walk around the roads and everything. So it's about road safety, because your field associates have to be on the roads throughout. So how do you ensure that the accidents are reduced? How do you ensure that you are able to look after the health of an associate or a well-being of the associate? So they give them these 15-20-minute augmented reality sessions wherein they help them maneuver through various roads, bottlenecks, traffic, and all that.
That's interesting.
So various ways of doing it, but yes, as an organization, you'll have to think through what is it which will work best for you. Which category of employees are you catering to? Not everybody would be happy. So maybe if you talk to, if you want to cater to the training needs of leadership, they might not be very comfortable with augmented reality.
Definitely.
Right? They might want to go for coaching, mentoring, or one-to-one sessions, or very small groups of focused sessions. So you'll have to identify and understand whom are you catering to, what is the requirement, what is the outcome expected, and then define your complete T&D strategy around it.
Makes sense. So customizing it per departments and per roles also.
Yep.
So that's where your point where you mentioned about identifying is the most important.
That's
now,
right.
This brings me to my next point, which is once you've identified and you've bridged the gap, how do you measure and validate these skills? So in any organization, what metrics can you use to measure how effective the skill development programs are? And then how can they ensure that, you know, the employee skills are future-proof, as they say?
Honestly, if you ask me, when you say employee skills are future-proof, that's something which is not possible, right? Because future is changing. It's a dynamic world. What is required today might be outdated tomorrow, and you will need an upgradation or a change or a new thing. Okay, so that's one. Number two, in terms of measurement matrix, it's a historical fight which has been continuing to have a return on investment, return of investment on L&D. Okay.
True.
I am spending X amount on these 3 days offsite workshop. What is it that I'll get out of it?
Yeah.
Get a transformed group of leaders. It doesn't work that way. But yes, there are various ways of looking at it. One, of course, when you talk about, let's say, leadership, okay? So what is the change in your business revenue, growth aspects, ways of strategy thinking, which these people are exhibiting now, right? So this is more of a mix of tangible and intangible that you'll have to look at.
Correct.
That could be one. Second, very, very basic in terms of could be, and it has to be, it's like the basic requirement, which is study the participation rates, have the completion rates, have the certification status, right? Take the feedback analysis. And okay, so these are very, very basic things. Then also, if it is a skill-based training, then what is the application or what is the usage of that skill in the day-to-day affairs is what you can understand. So for example, in my organization, we are a data-driven organization. So whenever I have to train a group of associates on data matrix, okay, on any statistical tools like Python or R or Tableau or anything, then for me, my efficacy of that program is that how well are my associates able to use those terminologies and methodologies in the next process.
Right.
Right. So how have I been able to reduce the errors which were initially happening? Have I been able to reduce the time which was taken in completion of the task now? Right. Have I been able to give some more window to my team leader because my associates are now self-managed, you know? So these are matrix again, which will depend upon what program are you referring to, what group are you referring to, right? For leadership, something else will work. For skills, something else will work. So for example, if you're in a manufacturing setup, so if you're training people on welding, so how well are people welding after that training is something which is a check.
Right.
Right. So this is how it works. So the matrix will get defined basis the training. But there are many matrix available. But again, there is nothing called any matrix which can say that, okay, I will give you an exact outcome of what you have spent, what you get. Not possible.
Makes sense. Makes sense. And there's one more point that you mentioned about time being saved. So till now, as the AVP of customer success, I have been trying to understand what is the learning hours that have been spent by the learners of an organization. However, there is a better or maybe a different parameter, which is how much time have they saved in doing the same activity, which will be a great way to understand the effectiveness of any training program or any skills that they've acquired.
Absolutely, because you know, I picked that up. I actually picked that up from schools, from my kids, if I look at it. So when you teach them cursive writing or anything, initially they take more time, but after that, once they get into that flow, that homework which was taking an hour to be completed gets completed in half an hour. So that's the saving that you have done by investing your time and efforts in making them learn cursive writing. Very simple, basic thing, right? We don't think about it, but it has shown an outcome, and the time that they took in completing an examination paper.
Makes sense. So now, again, in your opinion,
how can organizations ensure that every employee has access to development opportunities?
Okay, so when you talk about skill development, Pragya, I personally believe that whenever an organization is devising its talent development strategy, it should bifurcate into two broad categories. One category, the first category, should be accessible and available and designed for everyone across, irrespective of their roles, levels, experiences, genders, anything. So, for example, time management, respect, okay, sexual harassment policy. So all these things should be easily accessible and available for everybody. The second category has to be very specifically created and strategized for the function and for the group of associates and their levels and roles that you're catering to. You know, you cannot really expect, let's say, a leadership group to be sitting into a presentation workshop.
Yeah.
Okay. Or maybe a group of, let's say, 4 years, 5 years of experience sitting into strategy workshop. Right? It won't make sense for them. Right? So for them, I think it has to be very clearly defined and aligned with their roles and the expectations from their roles. So that would be the first requirement. After that, then of course, basis each category, you'll have to further define your strategy. As I said, the first category should be accessible to all. So it should be very clearly aligned with DE&I, right? So diversity, equity, and inclusion should be a very critical part of that, okay? It should be very inclusive in terms of ensuring that genders, neutrality of genders, race, etc., do not get highlighted in any of the programs in any manner. So you'll have to be very careful in terms of the content also there. Mm-hmm. Right? At times we do not think about it, but somehow we just speak something that does not fall into that line of inclusivity.
Right.
Yeah. So that would be one. Then we should always have a standard requirement of managerial support, right? So you want your associate to be trained, but the manager of the associate says, I'm sorry, I cannot release you.
Yeah.
I cannot give you that bandwidth. You know, I can give you half a day only, or you don't have time to do follow-up sessions or projects, right? So all those things you should have a clear alignment with the managers beforehand, right? Otherwise, you would actually stress out the participant rather than making him or her learn.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, while creating the programs, even in the first category or in the second category, I reiterate myself, need assessment or the T&I is extremely critical, okay?
Right.
So, for example, if I say data interpreters, okay, this is a group of data people that you are talking about and you have to train them. Do you think they have a need for presentation skills? No, not immediately. Yeah. They have something else as a requirement. Right? These people are not supposed to be, let's say, communicating with anyone. So it's like a back office job. Do they need workshop on communication? Not immediately, maybe sometime later. Maybe they need more of written communication as a knowledge or as a skill set. So you have to understand what is the requirement of your organization at large, then functions and then roles. And then define it accordingly. And that would bring in involvement, that would bring in participation, that would encourage everybody to join those programs happily.
Hmm.
Okay?
Makes sense.
So make them exciting, make them inviting, and ensure that the backup work, which is alignment with the managers, ensuring that they have the time, etc., they should be available at the right flexible work timings, work hours, it should not be that the person will have to travel too much or unnecessarily get into trouble and all that. All those things, logistics are taken care of. Right?
You make it as easy for them.
Absolutely. See, you want your participants to be learning there without anything else going on at the back of their minds.
Yeah.
Without stressing out on anything. So make that a happy experience for them. That okay, I'm here to learn. Let me learn. And how now I should think, how do I use this in my next day's work?
Right.
Yep.
Makes perfect sense. Yeah. And then I have a question that I'd actually like to break up in two parts.
Sure.
Because I'd like to understand what are the emerging skills that will be critical for the workforce in the next 5 to 10 years. But I'd like to know it from the point of someone who's just about to enter the workforce and also someone who's in mid-management, because senior leaders usually know what they're doing. So sure. In your opinion, for a fresher, what would be, you know, a few critical skills that they know they'll be able to use after a couple of years, and something similar for a mid-manager, middle management?
For a fresher nowadays, big data is something which is really critical. They need to know the data. They need to have the ability to read the data, because they have the skill sets in terms of, all of them learn statistical tools in their colleges nowadays.
Yeah.
They know about those tools, but when it comes to reading the data and making a story out of it is something that they need to pick up.
Okay.
Having an Excel sheet of 400 data points is good, but what is that for? What is those 400 data points telling you? What is it that you can infer out of it? What is it that you can decide basis that data is important? How can you make that information useful is important.
Okay.
All of us fill these one-pager surveys, etc., on a regular basis whenever we travel, go out to a mall or anything. You have many people just walking up to you. We just need your name and number, right? But when you have all these names and numbers put together, it runs into thousands of rows and columns. Now, what do you do with that? What is the usage of that data, right? I have all my data. So Google and all these platforms have immense data available.
Yeah.
What can you do with that data is what they should understand.
Right.
So this will also, in a way, take care of helping them control the cyber crimes, right? Because it's very easy nowadays. You know, these youngsters don't feel or don't realize that they are sharing their information at just a click of a button. They go to Instagram, like something, buy it right there. That means their information is flown in. And that's where they get caught.
Yeah.
So they need, once they understand that how the data is being used, they will themselves be cautious in not sharing their personal data that often.
Yeah. Makes sense.
So that would be one big requirement. Then second, not really in terms of competencies and all, but for youngsters, what I personally believe and my observation is that these youngsters need to learn the way of hard work. Nowadays, this generation is an entitled generation, right? So these kids are, they have their financials taken care of. Lot of them feel that as soon as you put a little more pressure to them in terms of work requirements, they are ready to flee.
Yeah.
Right, they just leave you at the drop of a hat. My manager shouted at me. My manager called me on a Saturday. He made me work 2 hours extra. I had a plan for a Friday. My leaves were not granted. I have already made plans with my friends. Right, so this is harsh. this is really harsh. I'm not being treated well. You shouldn't do extra work if you're not paid extra. So these are the standard statements that we hear it. And it's not only from employees. These are the statements which are coming in straight from the college students program. I went to a couple of colleges in the past wherein I had a discussion with students, and they questioned that why should we work extra hours? We shouldn't be doing it, because my manager would then just choose me for giving extra work all the time. I won't do it.
Yeah.
Okay. But if I remember when we started as employees long, many years back, I think since we had to look after the financials, this was never a choice. I'm not saying that you'll have to put in extra hours, or you'll have to do hard work, or you'll have to listen to a shouting manager. No, you know, raise your voice properly, but do not run away from the situation.
Yeah.
Handle the situation, handle the pressure.
Yeah.
That's a skill that they need to develop.
True.
Agree that you don't have to look after your family, because your parents are looking after that. But you should have an aspiration for yourself to have a better name along with the money.
Yeah. Yeah, I think consistency is what is required, where even a bit of inconvenience shouldn't lead a person to either leave a company or not have a dialogue with their managers.
Correct. Or bad mouthing. You know, a lot of these kids, even if they don't leave the company, they'll go to setups or platforms like Glassdoor and all and start talking negative just like that.
Yeah.
Very easy.
Just because they can.
Yeah. Okay, coming to the second part of your question, which is about the middle management.
Yes.
See, middle management have to ensure that they are well-versed with the changing dynamics of the market. For them, artificial intelligence, machine learning, technical knowledge, right? So as to say, a lot of middle-level people struggle with PowerPoint, working on Excel sheet, formulas, etc. So these are the things that they need to definitely have for them to grow. Right? Basics plus ensuring that they are well equipped with the changes in the market, which is AI, ML, cyber world, different technologies being used. Okay, so even if you talk about data, so there are different platforms like SAP, they have all developed and changed the entire process and the system management in the organization. So this group will have to really pick up on those skills.
Yeah, I think redundancy comes very easily in the middle management.
Absolutely.
And yeah, they need to keep upgrading and upskilling themselves even more than any other levels.
And the flip, the irony is that this is the group which really needs to cater to the financial needs of their families also. So they definitely need to invest in their personal upgradation rather than just being dependent upon the organization also. So they also need to think through that, what is it that they can do more? How can they have a cross skill also? There's no harm in picking up a cross skill.
Yeah. Perfect. That makes perfect sense. Thank you for answering all the questions that I had today. I had a great experience. Thank you so much for taking out time and giving us your valuable inputs.
Thank you so much, Pragya. I think the conversation was really interesting and insightful. Made me think also, because I think now when I go back to my organization, I'll have something more to add on the table.
Great. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure.